Good morning, everyone. God bless you on this Sunday morning. On behalf of the New Beginning Church of God Sunday School Department, our Pastor Bishop Leroy Odom, our First Lady Evangelist Willa Odom, and our Sunday School Superintendent Missionary Sabrina Morgan, we are glad that you decided to join us for another Sunday School lesson. We are in our spring quarter of the Union Gospel Series lessons, and our main theme of study is Proclamation of the Gospel. Our study today is found under Unit 1, Laying the Groundwork, and we are at Lesson 2, entitled God's Wrath Against Mankind. The lesson is based in the book of Romans, the first chapter, and verses 18 through 32. As our point of entry into this lesson, think about the following. The moon does not radiate its own light. It reflects light from the sun. The perceived shape of the moon is based on the angle that it reflects the sun's light. Its brightness depends on the amount of sunlight it reflects. A full and bright moon is an indication that the moon is reflecting a maximum amount of sunlight. The dark side of the moon is the side facing away from the sun. Without the sun, the moon would be completely dark. Similarly, God is the light of humanity. Without God, mankind lives in spiritual and moral darkness under his righteous wrath and judgment. In this week's lesson, Paul describes humanity's condition without God. God's wrath against mankind, our aim, to discuss Paul's description of human depravity and God's just wrath. Depravity refers to the quality or state of being corrupt, evil, or perverted. Life application, what we want to think about during the course of our week. To offer praise and thanksgiving for Christ's deliverance from God's just wrath. The events of this lesson take place almost 2,000 years ago, in or about 56 AD. As we always discuss, the biblical events of Scripture take place mainly in three continents, which are Europe, Asia, and Africa, as you can see circled here. Europe, Asia, and Africa. Corinth was an ancient city in Greece located in the area where this red circle is located in the upper left-hand corner right here. So Corinth is where Paul was situated in writing his letter to the Romans. As we stated, Paul is in Corinth as he writes this letter to the believers in Rome. So Corinth circled here in red. And Rome is the capital city of Italy. And you see Rome circled here, and this is Italy. So Greece and Italy are both located in the continent of Europe. Can mankind live morally upright without God? This question is often asked when discussing the existence of God. Most would agree that humanity is capable of good works. Even unbelieving people often demonstrate love and compassion toward one another. However, Scripture teaches us that all such works in themselves are worthless in gaining salvation. The spiritual reality is that people's hearts are full of sin and evil continually. We all need God. In last week's lesson, Paul proclaimed his confidence that the gospel was God's solution to the problem with humanity. And as we discuss, gospel is good news. The gospel delivers sinners from the penalty and power of sin. If men and women are to be saved, it must be through faith in Jesus Christ as proclaimed in the gospel. So in this week's lesson, Paul describes the humanity problem in detail. Let us begin our scriptures with Romans, the first chapter, the 18th through the 20th verse. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Paul declares in these verses that God's wrath is revealed against all the ungodliness and unrighteousness of humanity, none of which is committed in ignorance of God's character. So all the sin that's being committed is not in ignorance, meaning not knowing God's character and what he calls for. Paul states that people willfully suppress the truth. They don't want to believe the truth. They don't let it rise to the surface. So Paul states that people willfully suppress the truth of God that is manifested within them through the knowledge found in creation. Deep down inside, even the most radical atheist knows that God exists. God has revealed himself to humanity through creation. Just look at God's wonderful works. Bible scholars make a distinction between special revelation and the natural revelation. Special revelation refers to God's revelation of himself through his words and miracles. For example, the people of Israel received special revelation after God brought them out of Egypt. God did miracles on their behalf and spoke to them through Moses, giving them the law. The Bible we have today is the ultimate example of special revelation. Natural revelation comes as a result of looking at the creation. If we look out and consider life on earth and the wonders of the heaven above, it points to the Creator. If we look inward and consider the complex design of our body, this also points to the Creator. Therefore, mankind is without excuse in regard to sin. God's wrath is fully justified. Practical point tells us the sinful nature of man incurs the wrath of God. God has provided us with clear instructions for righteous living. Going on to Romans, the first chapter, the 21st through the 24th verse. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. When people reject God, they look for substitutes. Paul's first indictment against sinful humanity is that they exchange the glory of God for idols that represent mere creatures. So the first thing Paul talks about humanity has done is that they exchange the glory of God for idols that represent mere creatures. God is all-powerful and invisible. The true glory of God is too wonderful for human comprehension. It is foolish to imagine God as part of the created order. While people today rarely worship graven images, idolatry happens any time we put something else in the place of God. Let's do an idolatry check. And this is from the Life Application Commentary by Barton. Idolatry check. Here are some questions to help you see if your attitudes are like idolatry. Who created you? Did you say God? Whom do you ultimately trust? To whom do you look for ultimate truth? Did you say the word? To whom do you look for security and happiness? Who is in charge of your future? Did you say God? What do you think you can't live without? Who do you think you can't live without? What priority in your life is greater than God? What dream would you sacrifice everything to realize? Is God first place in your life? It's good to go through these questions sometime to let us know if God is in the forefront of our lives, or have we allowed something to sneak into the forefront that doesn't belong. The penalty for rejecting God's glory is fierce. God handed humanity over to their unclean thoughts and actions. Without embracing the light of God's special revelation, the darkness in mankind holds sway. When we talk about hold sway, we talk about rules and controls. So if you do not embrace the light of God's special revelation, the darkness in you is what controls. People continually live and act contrary to his righteous standards. Let's look at what Bruce Barton said in the Life Application Bible Commentary when he talks about a downward spiral. He says that Paul portrays the inevitable downward spiral into sin. When he wrote this letter, he gave example. He said, first people reject God. Next, they make up their own ideas of what a God should be and do. Then they fall into sin, sexual sin, greed, hatred, envy, murder, fighting, lying, bitterness, gossip. Finally, they grow to hate God and encourage others to do so. God does not cause this steady progression toward evil. Rather, when people reject him, he allows them to live as they choose. God gives them up or commits them to experience the natural consequences of their sin. Once caught in the downward spiral, no one can pull himself or herself out. Sinners must trust Christ alone to put them on the path of escape. In order to escape that downward spiral, you need to trust in God. You need to accept Christ as your Savior. So Barton basically describes what Paul was writing about and puts in an example of a downward spiral. So we don't want to be on a downward spiral in life, but we want to keep God at the forefront of our lives. We don't want to get caught up in humanity that does not believe and trust in God and believe that they can do things on their own and have their own imaginations of what is true. But we want to trust in God for what is true and rely on his word. A practical point lets us know that God requires repentance of sin. It is the only way to escape certain degradation and destruction. So when you talk about degradation, something degrading, going down, and destruction. So in order to get out of that downward spiral, escape that degradation and destruction, we must repent and rely on God and accept Christ as our Savior. That's where Paul is proclaiming the gospel. We ought to proclaim the gospel. Romans, the first chapter, in the 25th verse, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. The second indictment is that mankind exchanged the truth of God for a lie. So when we look at indictment, you know, I think about in the criminal world, a person that's up on a felony, put before the grand jury, their indictment or charges listed against them. So here, Paul's second indictment or charge is that mankind exchanged the truth of God for a lie. In the scriptures, truth is what corresponds to reality. In short, the truth is whatever God has spoken about a matter. Anything that contradicts the word of God is a lie. Romans 1st chapter, the 26th through 27th verse. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their woman did exchange the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. Recompense is what is owed, so for your actions, you were receiving your just due. The penalty, the just due for the actions, the penalty for rejecting the truth is that God handed mankind over to abnormal passions. By rejecting the light of God's truth, both women and men wandered into unnatural lusts. This sin is an obvious corruption of God's design for the human body. A practical point lets us know that God requires us to take a stand against sin in a fallen world. So it doesn't matter what others say or what popular opinion is, but the word of God is true and it is right. So we're required to take a stand against sin in this fallen world. Even though people do not abide by the word, we must abide by the word. It is the word of God that shows you true love and the word of God that will keep you in this day and time and on this journey of life. Romans, the first chapter, the 28th through the 32nd verse. These are our last verses. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. When we talk about reprobate mind, it's a wicked or corrupt mind. So those that did not hold fast to God, meaning keep them in their knowledge, meaning follow him, God gave them over to a wicked mind, corrupt mind. It was their choice as to what they did. To those things which are not convenient. So those things which are not convenient, convenient refers to being in, it has to do with being indecency. To do those things which are not convenient. So they did indecent things. Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity. So just to back up, when we talk about maliciousness, it's having or showing a desire to cause harm to someone. Full of envy, like hatred, murder, debate, deceit, has to do with falsehood, fooling one, a malignity, ill will or hatred, whisperers, backbiters, those people that cannot control the tongue and just talk about others and spreading gossip, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters. And when we talk about proud, it's not a good indication of proud where I'm proud of my child who did well. But we're talking about a person who's developed pride and the feeling that they're above everyone else. And doesn't even give God his just due. And they've done it on their own. Boasters, look at me, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, can't keep a word, without natural affection, implacable, relentless, unstoppable in evil doing, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. You know better, and you know the penalties of what you're doing, but you find pleasure in doing them. And not only do they do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. And you're almost encouraging others to do it and have pleasure in their wrongdoing. Paul's final indictment or charge against humanity is that they rejected God in their thinking. Humanity prefers to live as though God does not exist. Therefore, he is absent from all their plans and decision-making. God's not included in what you're doing. When you're thinking about where you're going in life and setting goals for yourself, you leave God out. We ought not leave God out in all that we do, because it's God that gives us the strength, the fortitude, and the insight to do what we do. When people reject God from their thinking, they are devoid of gratitude for all he has done, meaning empty of his gratitude, thanks for all he has done. So do not reject God from your thinking. Don't have a mind that's carved out and feels that God has no place in your life. They attribute God's actions to themselves or other created powers. Don't attribute what God has done, the blessings he has given you, all the power that he has, to anything else. God is God alone, and we ought to honor him. Most alarming, without God, there is no real foundation for moral living. That's very alarming, because without God, there's no foundation for one's moral living, what's the right and wrong of life. Then all people will do what is right in their own eyes. If there is no God and no judgment, then there is no incentive for moral restraint. What's going to hold you from going in the wrong directions? You don't even see a wrong direction, so there's no guideline for you. And there is no final justice for those who have suffered the injustices of this life. Oh, we need God. For justice, we need God. For direction, we need God. For moral living, foundation, restraints, we need God. Since humanity rejected God from their thinking, God handed them over to the penalty of a depraved mind. So those that did not follow, hand them over to a reprobate mind. Without the light of God, mankind's thoughts and motives became thoroughly corrupt. The floodgates opened up for every type of evil behavior. And that's reflective of the verses that we read. So we don't want to be given over to a reprobate, wicked mind, and we want to be guided by the goodness of God, by his direction, his love. God's love is so awesome. Practical point, the result of disobedience to God is death and destruction. Well, we want eternal life, so we want to follow him. Encouraging others in sin makes more likely the unbeliever's destruction. I tell you, you don't want to be implicit in someone else's downfall. You don't want to encourage the death and destruction of someone else. You don't want that on your conscience and on your person. Be a proclaimer of the gospel. Talk about the goodness of God. Help someone else understand and learn the love of God. Introduce them to the awesomeness of God. God is able to guide you. God is able to regenerate your spirit. God is just an awesome God, giving you joy on the inside. For our reflection today, Jesus Christ is the light of humanity. That is why Paul was so confident in the gospel message. Jesus Christ is the light of humanity. Sin is worthy of God's wrath. Wrath is anger. Yet we are not to hate people because they are sinners. Instead, we are called to love God and to love our neighbors as ourselves, even as we have a righteous hatred for sin itself. So we hate the sin, but I don't hate the person. I understand that there's another force working, an evil force working with respect to the sin. So I don't hate the person. I don't look down on the individual, but I introduce the individual to the gospel, to God. I love the individual, but I don't like the sin. So we have to get that straight in our minds, that we're not haters of individuals, but we may not like what is being done as far as the sin, but we ought to love our neighbors. And yes, that's another lesson in itself. Without Christ's salvation, humanity lives under God's righteous wrath. When we put our faith in Christ and accept his payment, for our sins, we receive not death, but forgiveness of sin and life eternal. Accept Christ today into your life. Oh, God is so wonderful and so awesome. We thank you for joining us for another Sunday school session. We pray that you have been enlightened and blessed. Until next week.
Listen, for those of you that are going through, for those of us that are waiting on his promise, understand God has not forgotten you. When times get tough, you got to look up to heaven and